they also involve many, many initiations. For example, his definition of numbers, which the modern mathematicians have not taken notice of. He defined numbers in the following way. Numbers are consciousnesses of space. They exist in space and they operate to germinate the universes. So, according to him, numbers exist long before the human mind exists. And he also describes a Lord who is called the Lord of Numbers, existing in space, expanding through time. That is one of his teachings. We can for a moment doubt how numbers exist without the human being. Because now we wrongly understand that numbers are evolved by the human brain. We are still unscientific to believe that numbers are the discoveries of the human brain. But if you go into the Indian scriptures, they say that there is a Lord of Numbers who teaches the whole creation according to the numbers and creates the living beings according to the number. It is said that he has taught the secrets of creation to his mother when he was still in his mother's womb. This is one of the allegories of the scriptures. It exactly tallies with the Pythagoras' definition of numbers. I will explain to you how numbers exist long before the human brain exists. If two eyes and two ears are created in the human embryo, two nostrils and two hands and two legs are created, two lungs are created, can you understand that number exists before human brain is created or not? This is a direct question which we can never avoid or escape. If you accept that 32 teeth are prepared in the human embryo, are you not to accept that there is a consciousness that governs numbers, which exists long before the human brain is made? If we accept that the number of bones in the human skeleton are always the same, are we not to accept that the number consciousness exists long before the human brain is made? If we accept that the atom has its own atomic number, irrespective of our knowledge of atoms, are we not to accept that numbers exist in space and they make the creation according to their own formulae? This is what Pythagoras meant. And in the ancient Indian scriptures, the nine numbers are called the nine lords of creation. They are called Prajapatis. And in the Old Testament, they are called the patriarchs. You will find Abraham, Jacob, etc., all these fellows. They are the same wonderful fellows who brought the creation to earth. Jacob has left his ladder still on the earth, for those who are not blind and deaf. The angels come down to earth via the head center through the vertebral column to form all the parts of the body in the embryo. And the human beings climb up the vertebral column in the name of spiritual discipline and yoga, so that they may join the cosmic and the planetary intelligences to work as scouts of this creation. So the ladder is there upon which the angels descend and the humans ascend. For those who ascend and descend, the ladder of Jacob still exists. Though for those who eat and sleep and die, even their vertebral column is a useless stick. So, we can understand the depth of wisdom Pythagoras had. And another definition is wonderful. His definition of A, among the definition of the various elements, he has defined air in the following way. Space is decomposed into spaces, and it is the birth of air. That is the definition of air. I think we have to go on to the second half of the 21st century before we can bring this sentence to the level of universities to be taught to students. So his concept of numbers, his definition of numbers, and his definition of space, and his definition of creation are stunningly scientific. He says that the whole creation is brought from seeming nothing to apparent something. So from seeming nothing to apparent something, the creation he compares with crystallization. The whole solar system is compared by him with a crystal. And he once again defines a crystal by saying that the crystals are shape conscious. Even today we have to accept that every crystal has its own shape. Though the scientist is not very ready to accept that the crystal is shape conscious. Unless we accept consciousness in every atom, we cannot explain why crystal preserves its own shape. We cannot explain the phenomenon of magnetism, the behavior of the poles and electricity, the alternation of currents, and the electron and the proton. Unless we accept mind in space, unless we accept mind in every unit of atom, unless we accept intelligence in every unit of atom, working out the plan of the atom, we have no means in the modern science to explain how the electromagnetic phenomenon works, how the law of magnetism works, how the lines of force along the poles work, how the electronic phenomenon works, how recollection is made in the brain, how information is fed by person to another person. In this age, when we have discovered electronic machines, when we know how to deal with computers, we know what feeding of information is, we know what programming is, then all these instruments are started by the human mind. However great your electronic machine is, however wonderfully programming it makes, it should be handled by you. That means the computer machine or the human brain. So the original computer machine is the biological mind, and it produces all other machines. This was known by the ancient scientists, and Pythagoras also knew it. That is what he means by giving his wonderful type of definitions. And his geometry, his understanding of geometry is another wonderful dimension. He gave to the world 33 volumes of wonderful wisdom. The 33 volumes exist today. They are taught from person to person, and there are professors and students who are teaching and learning from the time of Pythagoras till today. Of course, there are some fake organizations also.
The charlatan.
Especially in the 20th century, we have many imitation organizations that boast of teaching about Pythagoras. They speak of the pine, they speak of the circle, they speak of the right angle, and they speak of the set square. They speak of the compass. They speak of the spirit level. But they do not know the significance what Pythagoras meant. But still, they worship ignorance in their temples even today. By speaking in the language of masonry, one man questioning ignorance, another man answering in ignorance, spending thousands of francs for the regalia and paraphernalia which are meaningless. Even to purchase the jewels, some people are not capable of doing it. And each initiation, it incurs one dinner and some bottles. That is what the modern world knows about Pythagoras. We boast of triangles. We boast of the square as the fourth part of the circle. We boast of the point, the center of the circle, from which the disciple is not expected to err. Everyone is expected to discover his own geometrical center, which is equidistant from all the points around himself. That is the experiments with the objective world and keeping up the brilliance of the subjective consciousness, I am, as the center of the circle. So Pythagoras has given us 33 different triangles in geometry, and he has each triangle explained according to his own theorems. He was having a basket with sand from the river. Whenever a stranger came to him for wisdom, he gave a small stick to the stranger and asked him to draw a triangle. And when the stranger has drawn a triangle, Pythagoras could understand everything of the person by seeing the triangle. What proportions the three angles make, what perfection the straight lines they make, what was the amount of care he has shown for the perfection of drawing the triangle.
On this
he ran
knee.
It carelessly, like this. He used to understand the person. The upper angle he called it apex. The lower two angles he called the right and the left angle. The two angles on the base were used to read the duality of the person, his concept of good and bad, his concept of darkness and light, his concept of creation and non-existence, his concept of birth and death. All these things instantaneously he used to understand, make an estimate of the evolution of the person, and understood the need or no need of spiritual initiations to that person. If those who didn't want spiritual teachings still insisted upon having spiritual teachings, he used to teach mathematics so that the fellow ran away within a few days. He had wonderful sense of humor. One point he was repeatedly narrating to his disciples was this: the duty of every human being on this earth is that before he dies, he should see that the number of fools on this earth is reduced by one. That is himself.
C'est-à-dire lui-même.
And the number of wise men on this earth increased by one. And that is himself. Then you can do anything else. That is what he used to teach. Another wonderful thing for the students of Alice A. Bailey. You know, the full moon meditation. If you go through the book Discipleship in the Modern Age by Alice A. Bailey, you will know how the full moon meditation is to be made. Master Jwalkol, who is called the Tibetan master, he has given the method of full moon meditation. you are expected to close your eyes and meditate upon the full moon as the gateway of your existence. Sleep there. 7 steps from your side. You have to take these steps and wait there. The doorway which is round will be opened and you will be admitted into the other side of the moon. This, you must know, is the full moon meditation first given by Pythagoras to his disciples. Master Jhwalkul has taken this from Pythagoras, because according to many masters of wisdom, Pythagoras is one of the direct gurus of Master Jhwalkul. You must know that Master Kuthumi is a reincarnation of Pythagoras. And Master Jhwalkul is a disciple of Master Kuthumi and Master Maurya. This is the origin of the full moon meditation. And if you go into the original texts of the Yajurveda, one of the 4 Vedic texts, the same full moon meditation is given. It is said that the moon is the gateway of your consciousness. The new moon is the lid which you have to open for the gate. And the full moon is the pathway from your side to the other side of consciousness. That is what the passages of the Yajurveda say. Yajurveda. The sentences of Pythagoras exactly the same. And the description of Master Jhwalkul about full moon meditation is exactly the same. 2 outstanding aspects should be mentioned before we complete the biography of Pythagoras. Some people criticized him that he married a second time when he was old. But it was his disciple who was always with him. She was his first disciple, and she saw him becoming old. She wanted to serve him on the spiritual path for whatever he wanted. She also understood that he was a taskmaster in discipline, and that the disciples will gradually leave him because they cannot put up with him, and that he will have a very hard time and lonely time during his old age. So she made the great sacrifice.
She's?
Because she was one of the very few people who knew what his life was. So this is one of the peculiar aspects in his life. And the next aspect is his discipline. And he used to teach what he wanted to teach to his disciple, especially mathematics and medicine, and to some people music. In fact, many disciples could not keep up the speed of his teaching. And in the daily life also, his discipline was unsparing. And he never spared anyone. And he actually sent away some disciples for lack of discipline. Some of them remained his disciples even though they went away long distance. In that respect, we can compare the modern master Gurdjieff also with Pythagoras. You know, one of the modern psychologists, Kenneth Walker, was one of the close disciples of Gurdjieff. Gurdjieff one day called Kenneth Walker and said, "You go away, never approach me." He was very much disheartened, because Kenneth Walker loved his master very much. After many years, suddenly one day Guruji called back Kenneth Walker and said, "It is for the sake of spiritual discipline I sent you out. The initiation I wanted to give to you is already there with you. Unless I sent you away, you would not have got this change. Now I wanted to see you, I have seen, you can go away." So the third day the disciple found that Guruji was dead. So 2 days before he left his body, he called his disciple and saw him and sent away. Like this, we have masters who are masters of discipline, but all people cannot appreciate. Disciples can follow their masters if there are ulterior motives. For motives of power, politics, or money, or name and fame, people follow people in the name of disciples or teachers. But real disciples are very difficult to find. So gradually, the false disciples of Pythagoras began to go away from him. And some of those whom he sent away, they took a deep grudge against him. And they understood that he was a crank and insane. And finally, when Pythagoras was with a few of his disciples in his house, the house was bolted outside on all directions and it was set fire. It is how Pythagoras left his physical body, according to some biographers. But many people know that Pythagoras still lives with the same continuation of consciousness. In the same way he is producing disciples, in the same way he is conducting his function of beautifying the creation and preserving the tradition of the ancient wisdom. This is, in short, a few points about the biography of Pythagoras. And of course, if we have to go into certain points to explain and understand, each lesson takes at least 4 or 5 lectures. You will find the same figures in the Secret Doctrine under the heading "The Days and Nights of Brahma." You will find the same figures and some more figures also in the Treatise on Cosmic Fire by Alice A. Bailey, and an explanation of how these great cycles work on this earth. I thank you all. 7 steps. Common accepted symbolism of the scriptures. The moon indicates the mind. The first step indicates the individual mind. The second step indicates the mass mind, that is the totality of the mind of the human being. The third step indicates the mind of individuality consciousness, which is common between the human being and other living beings. The fourth step indicates the mind of the personality consciousness. The fifth step indicates the mind of the soul consciousness or group consciousness. The sixth step indicates what is called the love of the planetary consciousness of our earth. The seventh step is where the moon goes into the sun every month to borrow his light, which is called the background mind or the mind of the solar logos. This is what he meant by 7 steps. And on full moon day, these 7 steps automatically take in us. And we will have a great blessing from 2 centers. one the head center and the head, the second the heart center of not individuals but the total humanity of this earth globe. The first is called Shambhala, the second is called the hierarchy. So, a blessing from both these centers is received when we conduct a group meditation on full moon day.
Not exactly the dates of the present Gregorian calendar, but the lunar dates have a direct relationship with Pythagorean numbers. If you take an ephemeris and count from the day of new moon, the actual the numbers taken as the first day, second day, third day, etc., they have a significance in Pythagorean system. So you have to convert them into lunar dates. Health.
Yes.
Physical and mental health was absolutely necessary for spiritual training. And for that, he has prescribed a system of diet. And he chiefly based upon the fact of uncooked food. He gave preference to milk and milk products, especially milk not boiled, and fruits and legumes not cooked. Honey and the various flowers like cauliflower, etc., and the leaves of certain trees after they are ripe and drop down from the tree, and pure water from the river and the lake. This is what he has prescribed. He has prescribed also butter and ghee. And one of the principles he has given for spiritual life is, but you should make it a point not to kill and eat. From the plant and from the animal also, you should eat without killing. That is what he prescribed for health and spiritual health. Yes, of course. Pythagoras was not impatient. Those who lived with him were impatient. The only thing is he had no compromise with weaknesses. That was his weakness. Everyone, whether great or normal, will have some weaknesses. Great men will have weaknesses along with their greatnesses. And others will have weaknesses without greatnesses. So his disciples could not put up with him. Golden verses.
Yes.
There are a few verses gathered by some publishers and published, but they are incomplete. I think many more verses are to be still gathered. At some places there are some gaps and they do not make much meaning at present. But there are sentences which embed great scientific truths. In fact, the definitions I took about the various things are from his golden lines. Of course, in the translation here and there, I made my own alterations about the definition of numbers, about the definition of space, definition of creation. They are all from his golden lines. But if we take some 5 or 6 lines continuously, each makes a separate dimension and a science in itself. For example, he said the 2, the 3 and the 4 and the 12. Like that they are cryptic. If you take his 3 and his 4, you can understand the geometrical secrets of the square with its diagonals.
which produce four triangles. Four means square, three means triangle. They produce the Kalu, which produce the 12 months of the solar year, with the two solstices and two equinoxes. And 4 plus 3 is equal to 7. They produce the 7 rays of the various living beings on this earth. The total lunar month, 1/12 of the solar year, forming 4 into 7, 28, the number of the calendar for reproduction, which is called the menstrual cycle. Like this, his poetry embeds many secrets of sciences. We have to take each aspect and explain each in 2 or 3 lectures. Because there is astrology and astronomy applied, and geometry and numbers applied, and the biological science applied. So we have to turn everything with 7 keys. So it is not so very possible in very short time. Biorhythmic curves. There is much connection. If we begin to make experiments, we will find wonderful connection between Pythagorean numbers and the curves. If we have the paperwork practically done, you will find how the designs and patterns of nature contain these numbers, especially the light waves and the sound waves, and the various cathodes of various substances, and the vibrations they produce. They contain the numbers that are given as periodicities by Pythagoras. The same wisdom should be explained in each age through a living terminology. That he has done once again. Because if we take any scripture of any nation, you will find the same formula and the same wisdom given. But they are given according to the language required in those days. And every age requires its own language and terminology. And unless one has lived the ancient wisdom, he cannot be a master of the inner keys of the wisdom. And Pythagoras once again gave all the keys of inner wisdom in the language which exactly fits the present generation also. So from his time up to the present century, his method of expression and explanation and definition became necessary, and now they are serving the purpose. So we can say he is once again a renovator of the ancient wisdom.